Mini chapter 17, the gal score, babe or gross newsfeed. Looking online next morning, Jaymi sees it is just as Herb promised. Numerous sources announce that today Bangdead has quietly rolled out a massive free offering to consumers everywhere. It's the first major plank of Ain't They Freaky, and the company promises it'll be a popular hit. It's the gal score, babe or gross newsfeed. This is a constant stream of images, videos, or pieces of text uploaded from around the world, presenting individual women who are rated for attractiveness by any member of the public, using Ain't They Freaky's Freakometer, from a highest score of 10 for Babest down to a lowest score of 1 for Grossest. Jaymi lets his gaze wander up and down this newsfeed stream, where new posts are popping up every few seconds, every one of them soon receiving scores and comments from multiple sources. He reads a few posts for half a minute or so. Then he shuts off the newsfeed, looks away from the screen, and closes his eyes. A wave of disgusted weariness breaks in him, with the intimation of a lifetime's sadness that this is the kind of thing most humans genuinely want to see, to do, to buy, to think about, and even to use up their lives for, and always will be. The ugliness and meanness of what Ain't They Freaky represents feel like nothing less than an assault, going far beyond the dreary one's hostility towards him in particular. What gigantic exhaustion. What shortfall from all our potentials. And what lovely freedom and ease there could have been in some potential world that is not the one around him. But right behind the backwash of that sluggish wave, a brainwave flickers up bright. The best way to stay sane and withstand the assault will be to create something inspired in response. To a newsfeed created by the dreary ones, his answer will be a proactive and original creation mined from his own humanity. Contemplating a world where the likes of Ain't They Freaky will always reign commercially supreme, it's a challenge to identify how to use his capacities in this way. But by degrees, the road forward becomes apparent. When his own games reach their commercial release, they will house his responses to the world, integrated and balanced. But until then, while he's still game building, he will be breaking his responses down into component parts. Pursuant to this, he will follow up on Amber by creating further in-game beasts. Then, as with Amber, he will incarnate them too, and send them out into the world as their own creatures, to interact in meat space. Once out there, they will be extensions of himself, embodying aspects of him. They will also flesh out his reactions to everything that Ain't They Freaky may reveal in its players. Whatever parts of himself he embodies in those incarnated beasts will then be enriched by the beast's own internal development, which will occur through their taking their own actions with their own volition out here in real life. And when he reaches the point of sealing the beasts up into his three games again, ready for commercial release, then the games will reap the benefit of all those enrichments. Each such enrichment fostered by his having delegated the labour of experience to the belly of a beast whose maturation will thus flow back into Jaymi's own output. Furthermore, each successive beast will contribute to the arc of Jaymi's own internal journey here on Electra Drive, the journey of his developing ability as a games creator, unfettered by corporate interference. From each beast to the next, he will utilise the same ingredients of progression and direction that he'd have been obliged to incorporate into any Bangdead development process, but this time assembled according to his own delirious truth and leveraged at his own more authentic angles. Starting with a ghost, functioning as a hook, he will progress to an inciting event, then a first doorway of no return, then a first pinch point, then a midpoint, then a second pinch point, then a second doorway of no return, and so to a climax, all capped and closed off by a resolution. A music of his own self. Glints in his own eyes, rendered into flesh. A few minutes later, he opens his programming software. He creates a blank new project file and names it Second Beast. Who will this second beast be? Well, let's see. His previous creation, Amber, is an alluring beast, and he was authentically triggered by external provocation, birthed out of Jaymi's need to wreak vengeance where deserved. However, it has to be admitted, Amber was also a creature of somewhat untextured gesturalness, as well as negativity. True, his facial appearance benefited from good casting, Rutger Hauer in Hitcher mode, but this too was an issue in itself, for it hardly constituted original creation, did it? It was an off-the-peg JPEG, to be nakedly frank. A low-hanging marzipan fruit, sweet to taste, but of little nutrition. A sample in a music track, dropped in with savvy and impeccable respect, but also with a low-crouching modicum of laziness. Or a Pop-Tart reaction of flashy derivation, but masquerading as ore that was hammered out from Jaymi's deeps by the clinking of a cursor before being winched up, blinking, onto a screen of blank white. Moreover, Jaymi's full response to Bangdad Games is not expressed in Amber alone. For greater balance, richness, and truth, perhaps a more benign, more human, more humane creation is needed, so as to complement the first one's harsh edges? Maybe Amber didn't quite add up to the Sermon on the Mount after all. Maybe he's a rung upon a ladder. So again, who will this second beast be? Someone who will embody not just Jaymi's pointed response to the Galscore, babe or gross, newsfeed, but something wider, his whole instinctive urge for ease and freedom in the face of the sheer authoritarian rigidity he can feel spurting out of him from every glyph and pixel of Ain't They Freaky. Okay. Who else is slated to appear in the Platinum Raven? Jaymi's early stage design for that game's world includes two characters who might be candidates for a second incarnation, the Platinum Raven and Scorpio. But neither of these feels light enough to complement Amber. Who then? He brightens to recall that the Platinum Raven is not the only game he has sketched out. There is also the Imagination Thief, whose entire game world is metafictionally contained within the surrounding world of the host in the attic. He has so far begun designing only three of the Imagination Thief's many characters, named Evelyn, Shigim, and Kim. And while he pictures this trio, barely yet picturable as they are, Evelyn raises her plucky little hand and waves it back at him. He nods in reply, realizing that this is his first reactive communication with her. Though still inchoate, she's already equipped with quite some awareness and volition of her own, it seems. Yes, now that he considers her, Evelyn does have the lightness to complement Amber. She may even have the strength to stand up to him too. Not by dint of force, but rather by dint of joy, if that makes sense. Of course it does. He consults the general sketch of her in his design for the Imagination Thief, then polishes it, so it reads, quote, Evelyn Carmelo is a driver who opens social doors. She is sunny, centered, straightforward, and kind, but also sassy, tough, and street smart. Joyously functional in the real world, she's a dirty, sexy party girl, although that scene is now in her recent past. Well, okay then, bring it on. Jaymi thinks for a moment longer, then he renames this new project, Evelyn. So, here comes a new beast, born into beauty and complexity, a creature of his own love and pain. Regrettable that Evelyn's sunny, cool freedom should be forced to look at and tangle with so ugly a counterbalance as the Galscore, babe or gross newsfeed, so boring the worries and so tight the limitations in such a sucking out of life, Jaymi is sure Evelyn would have things otherwise. That counterbalance would seem, however, to be compulsory.